syndromic short stature.
Okay.
With the following outline, what is syndromic short stature, how to suspect and diagnose, and what is the management approach? As we all know, short stature is defined as length below 2 standard deviation, below the mean for age and sex, or below 2.3 percentile, or roughly speaking, third centile, taking into consideration the parent's height, ethnic consideration, reference population, and pubertal staging. According to the SP classification, short stature or pathological short stature can be grouped into those with idiopathic short stature and primary growth disorder or secondary growth disorder. Secondary growth disorder can be secondary to the growth hormone deficiency, maybe either idiopathic, genetic, or associated with certain syndromes, or associated with brain tumors or brain anomalies like empty cell syndrome. Maybe secondary to the disorder growth hormone IGF-1 axis, like bioinactive growth hormone or abnormality in the growth hormone receptor. Maybe secondary to the other endocrine disorders and metabolic disorders. Maybe secondary to the psychosocial, like emotional deprivation, iatrogenic causes like glucocorticoid therapy, or secondary to the malnutrition or other disorder in other organ system. The primary growth disorders include clinically defined syndromes like Turner syndrome, Cornelia de Lange, Noonan, Prader-Willi, Silver-Russell syndrome, and also primary growth disorder include small for gestational age with failure to catch up and IGF-1 resistance. Also, it includes skeletal problems like chondroplasias, achondroplasia, hypochondroplasia, dyschondrosteosis, including SHOX gene deficiency. What is syndromic short stature? What is syndrome means? The term syndrome refers to a group of specific features which appear to be unrelated, but they develop together. Short stature has been reported in more than 1,300 genetic syndromes. Genetic causes of short stature were previously thought to be related to the growth hormone deficiency, but now it is established that these genetic anomalies, including different syndrome, are not directly associated with growth hormone IGF-1 axis problem. And so what is the cause of short stature in those syndrome, syndromic short stature? The cause of short stature is based on the cellular level. And in addition, wide variety of mechanisms, many of them are known and some of them are still unknown. For easy diagnostic approach, we can classify syndromic short stature into those group with intrauterine growth retardations, like chromosomal aberrations, non-Mendelian inheritance, like Russell-Silver syndrome, monogenic cause like 3M syndrome, Bloom syndrome, Kabuki syndrome, and those group without intrauterine growth retardation, including chromosomal aberration like Turner syndrome and Down syndrome, imprinting syndrome like Prader-Willi syndrome, monogenic causes like Laronne, skeletal dysplasias, and erythrosis. Another group is a group of syndromic short stature associated with microcephaly, like sickle cell syndrome, microcephaly, osteodysplastic primordial dwarfism, type 1 and type 2. So when we face a case of short stature, we have to search for dysmorphic features. Each dysmorphic feature can point to a specific diagnosis. And we focus on these: craniofacial manifestation, microcephaly, mental impairment, hearing and cardiac defects, cryptorchidism, photosensitivity, clinodactyly. Let's start by the first one, which is the SHOX gene deficiency. What is SHOX gene? It is present in the most tip part of the sex chromosome, whether it is Y or X chromosome, and it is located in a region called pseudo-autosomal region. It is important intrinsic non-endocrine factor for the development of the skeletal bone. So SHOX gene deficiency is most frequent monogenic bone disorder. It is associated with up to 15% of patients with idiopathic short stature, up to 90% of patients with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and almost always present in patients with Turner syndrome. And when there is both allele deficiency, there is Langer mesomelic dysplasia. It is more common in females, characterized by appearance of thinner fork of the wrist. It's called Medialang deformity, with shortening of the fourth and the fifth metacarpals, and in SHOX deficiency also, it is associated with mesomelic shortening of the extremities. Let's start by Leri-Weill dystrochondrosis. It is a skeletal dysplasia characterized by short stature starting since birth and Medialang deformity starting to develop from the mid to the late childhood, associated with increased muscle size, bowing of a bone of the tibia, elbow abnormalities, and the intelligence here is normal. This is the Turner syndrome patient with Medialang deformity of the bone arm, of the forearm, and with characteristic X-ray picture with the V-shaped appearance or the interface between the lower end of the long bones of the forearm and associated also with fourth and fifth metacarpal shortening. Langer mesomelic dysplasia, it is severely a shortened long bone of the limbs. There is deformity of the humeral head, angulation of the radial shaft, carpal distortion, femoral neck shortening, in addition to the hypoplasia of the proximal heart of the fibula. So when we have to screen for SHOX, if the diagnosis of short stature is not apparent or not documented, and there is Medialang deformity with first degree relative of SHOX deficiency, so we have to screen for SHOX mutation. Or if the extremities to the rank ratio below -1 standard deviation and characteristic X-ray pictures of the abnormality of the SHOX gene deficiency, then also we have to screen for SHOX deficiency. So we have to remember growth failure in SHOX deficiency starts early during the first year of life, body proportion in the form of mesomelia, and the characteristic radiographic findings are clues for the diagnosis. Growth hormone therapy is approved for patients with SHOX deficiency. Let's move to another group of syndromic short stature with microcephaly. This is the first one, Sickle syndrome spectrum disorder. It is a type of microcephalic primordial dwarfism characterized by proportionate dwarfism of prenatal onset, severe microcephaly, typical bird-like face, mild to severe intellectual disability, and up to 25% of patients suffered from hematological abnormalities with chromosomal breakage. And these are the genes mutations involved in the sickle syndrome spectrum disorder. Those highlighted in yellow are associated with defect in the DNA repair, and the rest ones are associated with the cell defect in the cell proliferation. So, is it possible to give growth hormone for those patients? It is not FDA approved to give to sickle syndrome growth hormone, but some researchers try to give growth hormone therapy for those patients, and they reported that there may be a good effect on the final adult height on those patients receiving growth hormone. The second one is microcephalic osteodysplastic primordial dwarfism type 1. It is an intratriline growth retardation associated with microcephaly, skeletal dysplasia, certain facial features, brain anomaly, intellectual disability, and the prognosis of those patients is very bad. They mostly die in the first year of life, and the treatment is only supportive. In type 2, it is characterized by dwarfism, microcephaly, and hip dysplasia with thinning of the bone of the arms and leg, high-pitched voice, cranial facies, including prominent of the nose, full cheeks, long midface, abnormal skin pigmentation, and the development is normal. Also, some researchers try to give growth hormone therapy for those patients, and the conclusion is there is no significant difference in the final adult height for both groups, those who received growth hormone therapy and those who didn't receive. Bloom syndrome. It is one of the chromosomal breakage syndrome associated with immune deficiency. It is an autosomal recessive and characterized by proportionate short stature, sun-sensitive facial erythema with variable intellectual ability, immune deficiency, sparse subcutaneous adipose tissue, and predisposition to the development of a wide variety of malignancies. And genetic diagnosis is very easy on standard karyotyping by finding excessive number of sister chromatid exchange, and also gene mutation detection is available. The management of Bloom syndrome is mainly supportive. No rule for growth hormone therapy for those patients. because of their chromosomal breakage and early development or high incidence of malignancy in those patients. Kabuki syndrome, characterized by both natal dwarfism, mental retardation, and certain peculiar fissures, long palpebral fissure with eversion of the lateral third of the lower eyelid. In addition to the other abnormalities found in the heart, skeletal system, and immune system. 3M syndrome characterized by short stature of prenatal onset, relatively large head, dolichocephaly, triangular face, and usually it is one of the differential diagnoses of Russell-Silver syndrome, and I will tell you how we can differentiate between both of them. In addition to the presence of short, broad neck, prominent trapezii, hypogonadism, hypospadias, and the intelligence here is normal. We can differentiate it from Russell-Silver syndrome by the characteristic radiological features. The long bones are slender with diaphyseal constriction and flared metaphyses. Femoral neck are short. Vertebral bodies are tall with reduced both transverse and anteroposterior diameter. Thorax is relatively broad and slender. Bone age is slightly delayed, in addition to the presence of dolichocephaly and elbow dysplasia. Genetic diagnosis is available for those patients, and the treatment mainly also supportive for the joint laxity and follow-up and monitoring of the gonadal function. Those patients, when associated with growth hormone deficiency, so they are candidate for growth hormone therapy. However, some researchers try to give even patients without growth hormone deficiency, try to give them growth hormone therapy, and they found good response in the height standard deviation, in the growth velocity, and in the final adult height. So the treatment of syndromic short stature can be recombinant treatment, has been introduced in several syndromic causes, which disorder with short stature, regardless of their growth hormone status. However, in some other syndromes like Bloom syndrome with high incidence of malignancy, growth hormone is not advocated. These are the FDA indications for growth hormone therapy in syndromic cases, Turner syndrome, Prader-Willi syndrome, SHOX gene deficiency, and Noonan syndrome. In ancient Egypt, short people were highly respected and they were given money and golden medals for their shortness. Let's review together some case studies. The first case is an 11 and a half year old boy presented with short stature, full term and eventual pregnancy, body weight 3 kilograms, length 48 centimeter. The mother reported difficult feeding in the first year of life and delayed motor development. He was operated upon at the age of 1 year for bilateral and ascended testes. He has the specific features in the form of high broad forehead, hypertelorism, downward slanting of palpebral fissure, thick posterior rosated ears, micrognathia, high arched palate, and pterygium coli. The height was on minus 2.4 standard deviation, and midparental height was on 0.4, minus 0.4 standard deviation score, and the predicted adult height was on minus 3 standard deviation score. There was no scoliosis, IQ 75. All lab investigations were normal, apart from the bone age was done and it was delayed. So what's your suggestion about the diagnosis of this case? It is Noonan syndrome, and diagnosis can be relied on the clinical scoring system, presence of one major criteria plus two minor criteria, or one minor plus two major criteria can be a definitive diagnosis of Noonan syndrome. And also there is a chromosomal or a genetic study that can approve the diagnosis of the Noonan syndrome. Noonan syndrome is one of the rhabdopathies. It is a medical genetic syndrome characterized by mutation in the genes encode for the component or regulator of the RAS-MAPK pathway, which is very important in the cellular proliferation, differentiation, motility, and apoptosis. There were concerns about giving growth hormone therapy for patients with Noonan syndrome because its effect on the cardiac diameters or cardiac geometry in patients with congenital heart disease, and also being one of the rhabdopathies, it may be associated with malignancy like neuroblastoma or low-grade glioma. However, many studies were done, and this is one of the systematic review, evaluated 15 clinical trials and 4 observational studies about growth hormone therapy in patients with Noonan syndrome, and they found that it is effective, can improve the growth velocity, standard deviation, and final height, and also with no concern about the cardiac geometry or the malignancy. So this child was started on growth hormone therapy on a dose 0.04 milligram per day with improvement of the height standard deviation in the following the 6 months of treatment. It reaches a high standard deviation of minus 2 standard deviation score after 6 months of treatment. So the learning points, Noonan syndrome manifestation are prominent in the early childhood, should be spotted early for initiation of treatment. Growth hormone doesn't appear to be associated with adverse cardiac event and no concern about malignancy. It is very important to monitor for other associated anomaly in those patients. The second case is a 4-year and 10-month-old Sudanese girl presented with obesity and short stature. She was born after full-term uneventual pregnancy. Her body weight was, birth weight was 2.4 kilograms with no reported length. She had difficult feeding, hypotonia in the first year of life with delayed motor development. She had delayed speech and snoring and, most important, obstructive sleep apnea. After the age of 1 year, she developed hyperphagia, progressive development of obesity with decreased activity, and she was aggressive. The height was on minus 2.4 standard deviation. Her body mass index was on plus 4 standard deviation. She had wide leg gait. IQ was 80 and no clear letters on speech. And this is these are her investigations, showed microcytic hypochromic anemia, hyperlipidemia, blunted growth hormone response, and vitamin D deficiency. So what's your suggestion about diagnosis of this case? Yes, it's a bladder Wiry syndrome, can be diagnosed also based on clinical scoring system. At the age of 3 years onward, we can, if the child achieved 8 points from the major and minor criteria, so the diagnosis of Prader-Willi can be established. This patient achieved 5 points in the major criteria and 3 points in the minor criteria with a total score of 8 and was diagnosed as Prader-Willi syndrome. Genetic testing is also available for diagnosis of Prader-Willi syndrome. This patient underwent first adenotonsillectomy for her hypertrophy of the adenoid and tonsils and her obstructive sleep apnea. And then growth hormone therapy started at a dose 0.03, 4 milligram per kg per day, together with diet education, calcium, vitamin D, speech therapy. The patient showed marked improvement when growth hormone was started. But due to lack of supply of growth hormone for a limited period of time, there was deceleration and bad growth velocity in a certain period of time. And after restart of growth hormone again, the child showed marked improvement. There is improvement also in the body mass index, her speech, and in the cognitive function. Regarding the cognitive function, also other studies reported improvement of the cognitive function of Prader-Willi syndrome with growth hormone therapy. The learning points here, growth hormone is a cornerstone in the management of children with Prader-Willi syndrome. It stimulates the height, velocity, body composition, physical activity, cognitive function. Respiratory assessment is very important prior to the start of growth hormone and no enough data to support the continuing growth hormone into the adult life. The last case. Girl presented with 6 years with short stature. She is the second child of healthy non-consanguineous parent. She was born after an eventual term pregnancy. No perinatal complications. The birth weight was 2.2 kilograms and birth length 48 centimeters. The mother claims that she had a poor appetite. Her specific features were small triangular face, prominent forehead, peaked nose, narrow chin. Her head circumference was normal, but it is relatively large in relatively to the rest of the body. She had clinodactyly and average mentality. Her height was on minus 3 standard deviation score, and mid-parental height was on minus 0.1 standard deviation score. She was prepubertal with normal other system examination. Her investigations showed mild hypochromic anemia and delayed bone age. So what's your diagnosis? Yes, Silver-Russell syndrome. Also, Seldon-Raffles-Russell syndrome can be diagnosed in clinical scoring system. The child achieved 4 or even 5 out of these 6 criteria, including small for gestational age, postnatal growth failure, relative macrocephaly, protruding forehead, body asymmetry, feeding difficulty. The child achieved 5 out of 6 points, so that it was diagnosed on clinical basis of Seldon-Raffles syndrome, in addition to the presence of other manifestation of Seldon-Raffles syndrome. Genetic study is available to diagnose Seldon-Raffles syndrome. Genes mutation can be found on chromosome, mainly number 7 and 11. Other chromosomal involvement is also present. There is consensus about the management of those patients with growth hormone therapy, and the growth hormone was started at this at a dose of 0.35 milligram per kg for this patient, together with nutritional evaluation to provide optimum caloric intake. Monitoring of early adrenarch advancement of the bone age for early detection of central puberty is very important. That may necessitate LHRH treatment in this patient. So the learning point here, Seldon-Raffles syndrome should remain the primary clinical diagnosis. Molecular testing is available, can help in the diagnosis. Growth hormone therapy is very important to improve the growth velocity and the final adult height by about 1.2 or 1.4 standard deviation score. It's very important to monitor central puberty in those patients on treatment to introduce LHRH if needed. And the take-home message, search for syndromic feature in any case with short stature is very important. Proper diagnosis and early diagnosis is important to initiate early treatment for good response. Growth hormone is approved for some syndromic cases, but not advocated in cases with chromosomal breakage. And multidisciplinary team is very important for proper management of those patients. I found this article is very helpful. It is collected all syndromic short stature with all gene mutations related. So I would like to share this article with you. It is very important, and thank you.